Welcome to my session on intellectual property rights, cyber law and cyber crimes. I'll first walk you through the intellectual property rights and then we'll move on to the cyber law and cyber crimes a little later. Now, the moment we say intellectual property, we're talking about the property which is a product of your intellect. So, generally what we do is we classify property as either tangible property or intangible property. So the property that you can touch, feel and see is what we call as the tangible property, and a product of the intelligence is called as the intellectual property. So is it intangible? No, it is not. It will still figure out as a particular product which you are going to register, but since it is the effort of the intellect, so we call it as an intellectual property. So earlier when people were artistic, or when people used to sing songs, or when people used to write books, these were not protected. So it was very easy for people to go ahead and copy it or to reproduce the same thing. So over a period of time, people started realizing that, hey, the product of my intellect has got some value in the market. There are takers. So let me go ahead and commercially exploit it. So when this concept of commercial exploitation came in, there was a need for certain laws also to be introduced. So that is how we come up with this intellectual property rights, which protect the rights of this person who has this particular product which has come out due to his intellect. Now generally the concept under intellectual property rights is mostly a negative right. That means to say that I will stop you from using my product in any manner which is going to infringe my rights. Now as time proceeded, this intellectual property rights was also found to be exploitable in other parts of the world. So the laws which were there in the domestic forum were not similar to the ones which were there in the international forum. So there was a need for standardization. So when this need for standardization came, the World Intellectual Property Organization called WIPO, which is one of the 15 specialized agencies of the United Nations, came with the WTO, and they introduced what we call as the trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights, which is called as TRIPS. This was introduced in the year 1995. So the signatories to this particular agreement were required to standardize their protection with regard to intellectual property rights across the world. So they introduced that the term of each of this intellectual property will be similar across the world. They also said that the registration processes could also be standardized to a very great extent. So that is how the intellectual property rights started getting recognized. So since this TRIPS came into effect in the year 1995, the signatories were also given 10 years to come up with laws. Either they could amend the domestic laws which were already existing, or if they did not have a law on a particular intellectual property right, then they could go ahead and enact a new law as well. So we did have the Copyright Act and the Patent Act earlier, but with becoming a signatory to the TRIPS, we had to rewrite a few things, so it had to be amended. So there is a list of intellectual property rights. Under the intellectual property, you have multiple protections. And the first one that I'm going to talk to you about is the Copyright Act. Now the Copyright Act is the Act of 1957. The other intellectual property rights are the Patent Act, then you have the trademark, you have the geographical indications, you have the designs, you have the semiconductor integrated chips, you also have the protection of plant varieties, which we will just look through. So with regard to the Copyright Act, let me ask you a few questions. Suppose if you have read the book Harry Potter, and subsequently it has been made into a movie. Have you thought, how is it that a book is made into a movie? Has it violated the copyrights of the author? Let us say, for instance, there are a lot of these performances and things like that, and in most of the performances you are performing somebody else's dance number, let us say a popular movie, and you are performing a song from that particular movie. So are you violating anybody else's copyright? Suppose I have, I'm singing a song, I'm not creating it myself, I am singing something which somebody has already written. Am I violating their copyright? Let us say, for instance, if I'm recording a meme or a video on TikTok, which is very popular now, you use a lot of dialogues from movies, and then you just act like a few people. So is it violative of any kind of copyright? What about buildings? Okay, suppose if I'm going to draw inspiration from a particular monument, and if I want to build my house in that particular way, am I violating anybody else's copyright? Similarly, let us also say with regard to software, we all believe in sharing and caring. So let us say, for instance, my friend buys a software CD, I would want to use the same CD and I would not want to spend money. So am I doing anything wrong there? So these are a few questions that I want you to ponder about, and I will walk you through the act. I will tell you what the protection is, and in case there is an infringement, what kind of remedy. Now, ideal case scenario, we may not be creating an intellectual property right, but why you still have to know is so that you do not infringe upon anybody else's rights. So not only from a creator's perspective, but also from an infringement perspective is what we are looking at with regard to all the intellectual properties. So the moment you say copyright, it doesn't mean that you have a right to copy. What we say is you do not have a right to copy. That means I am saying if my work has been registered, you do not have a right to copy my work. So I have a copyright protection against you. So what is the subject matter of copyright? Anything which is worthy of copy is worthy of protection. Okay, so if it is something that you think that somebody else can copy, again, here we are not talking about the quality, we are not saying that it is the best form that you have done, but then if it is something which is something which somebody would be interested in copying it, go ahead and register it. A lot of times what happens is, when we are in conversation, particularly with friends, what we do is we say, hey, I have this great idea. I want to write the script, okay? So I just got this, last night I was sleeping, and then I just thought that I should be writing about this particular incident which happened in my life, and I think I can dramatize it in such a manner that it can be a bestseller. And then your friend says, oh yeah, okay, let's hear what it is. And then you narrate the whole story, and then you tell them, see, this is what happened. And you say that, I've been planning to write about this for a very long time. But then, too much work, and with this COVID situation, work from home, I'm so tired, I'm not able to devote much of work. Well, after this conversation happens, a couple of weeks go by, and suddenly you see a small short story in either a magazine or newspaper which your friend has published. And the story is very similar to what you had narrated to your friend. Now you are taken aback. You said, oh, this is my idea. This is what I had discussed with him the other day, and you had just blurted out. But can you now go ahead and sue that person? The law says, no, you cannot. Because what you had was only an idea, and your friend has gone ahead and given expression to that particular idea. So under the Copyright Act, an idea cannot be protected. But yes, anything which has been given an expression is copyright protectable. Now, if your friend decides to register it, now this is again a unique feature of all the intellectual property rights. There is no mandate, or it doesn't require you to mandatorily register your intellectual property, but it is more desirable from the fact that if you register, you get a set of rights along with those particular products which are registered. So now let us say that your friend goes ahead and he is also claiming now what he had written as a short story, he goes ahead and publishes it as a small book, and he now gets complete, he gets it also registered. So now he has absolute rights over it. He can go ahead and exploit this right further. He can go ahead and make this book into a movie. So he gets what we call as a bundle of rights. So once you register your copyright, what all can be given to you is a bundle of rights to reproduce, to exploit, and things like that. So you get the right to reproduce and to control the publication. You can also get copies issued. You can get that particular work publicly performed. You can also make translations or adaptations into any other language or into any other form. And under the Copyright Act, what all can be protected is not just the literary work. Okay, it can be the dramatical work, it can be a musical work, it can be an artistic work, it can be a cinematography film, it can be sound recording, anything can be protected. And the term of protection of this particular copyright is the lifetime of the author. So the author is a general reference that you make to the person who has created this particular copyright. And along with the lifetime of this person, you can add on another 60 years. So that is lifetime of the author plus 60 years is the term of that particular copyright. So if your friend has written this particular book, you have to wait for him to die. And then you have to also wait for another 60 years for you to make any changes to it. Let us say, for instance, that you're not very happy about the way he has projected your idea. You had better ways of dramatizing it. You had better ideas. But then since you did not put it into an expression, now you're not able to register it. Rather, your friend has already gone ahead and registered it. So if you also want to create a work, you need to be very sure that it is not substantively similar. So what can be protected under copyright is an original work. That means it has to be something which has not been published earlier or which has not been done earlier. And this originality has to be maintained throughout. Now, let's just go to the remedies which are available. Now, suppose, say, for instance, like I said, once you register your copyright, what am I getting? Because there is a lot of money involved in registering, isn't it? So what am I going to get in return? Of course, you get your rights protected from anybody else exploiting your work. Other than that, if there is somebody who goes ahead and exploits your work, then you can sue them for infringement. So when I say sue, I'm talking about a civil relief. There is criminal relief as well, but then I'll be talking more about the civil relief. Under the civil relief, the first one is what we refer to as the Anton pillar. Now, Anton pillar is a methodology where you can have a search and seizure. Let us say, for instance, there is a particular movie which is released. And by default, most of them don't want to go to the movie theaters, and particularly with this COVID situation, you do not want to take a risk at all. So what you do is you go ahead and get a pirated version. So when you get a pirated version, and if you are going to convert it into a series, and if you're going to keep it for distribution, and if this goes out, and if there is a search and seizure, this is called as an Anton pillar action. So they can come and seize all those pirated CDs, and they can also seize them and take them away. The second thing is with regard to injunction. Injunction is generally permanent injunction, but till the court is going to decide to stop the person from exploiting your copyright anymore, you can also ask for what we call as a temporary injunction. So you're going to immediately stop the person from exploiting your copyright anymore, and you're going to stop them from doing it perpetually as well once you get a permanent injunction. Now, let us say, for instance, because of this infringement, you have also suffered damages. Now, damages can be twofold. One is for the very fact that the person has infringed your copyright. And the second one is for the fact that the person would have converted it into any other manner. Let us say, for instance, if this book, if I have written a book and if you have converted, that into a movie, so you have infringed my copyright. Now, yeah, there can be a disclaimer saying that, you know, anything fictitious, it's only a matter of coincidence. Anybody living or dead is only a matter of coincidence. But then if you're able to read my book and if you're able to see the movie and if you're able to say, hello, it looks very similar, then in that case, yes, I can surely sue you and I can get damages for that as well. Other than that is also the accounts of profit. That means if you have made any profits or you have put me under loss and if you have made any particular profit, that can also be recovered. One of the new entrants into this reliefs is what we call as the Ashok Kumar or the John Doe relief or a John Doe order. Now, some time back, there were movies like Lipstick Under My Burqa and Harry versus Sejal, which was released. Now, it was released on the online platform as well, and there was a lot of loss which was suffered by the producers. So, when it goes online, the problem is you do not know who is on the other side. That is, you don't know who your opponents are. So, this is a unique kind of a relief which was granted, asking all the internet service providers to pull the movie off viewing. So there were multiple orders which were given. So in case you don't know who your opponent is, this kind of action is also possible. Let's now go to the next form of intellectual property rights, the most popular one. The moment you say IPR, the first thing that comes to your mind is a patent. Now, a patent is given either to a particular process or it can be given to a product as well. So what can you actually patent? Anything under the sun. If you can come up with any new innovation, and if that is something which is an invention, then automatically you can get a patent. Now, the beauty of intellectual property rights is that we do not stop you, or we do not tell you what are all the things that you can register. We rather tell you what are all the things that you cannot register. Obvious reason is that it is your intellect. Now, you don't know what you are going to think next. So how is it that the law is able to project or look into the future and say, okay, this is what you can produce? So under the intellectual property regime, the very beauty of the protection is that you can go ahead and do anything that your mind says. Of course, it has its own small boundary as well. So we tell you what not to make. What to make is completely left up to your intellect. Again, it depends on the time, the requirement. There are multiple factors which contribute towards this. So in case of a patent, there are three things which are required. First one is it has to be novel. That means it has to be an invention. When I say invention, there is a very clear distinction between invention and discovery. So if it's something which is already existing in nature, you will not be able to go ahead and get a patent on it. It has to be something which you have come up with. So it has to be an invention. Invention can be anything. Let us say, for instance, if you just look at the kind of products that you're using, for instance, the first mobile phone which came, or the first laptop which came, or let us say, for instance, any of the equipments that you're using, anything can be registered under the patent regime. So you are looking at innovativeness, that is, you're looking at novelty. It could be a product or it can be a process. Let us say, for instance, to make a particular product, I am taking about 10 hours. But if somebody is able to make the same product, and by altering the process, if he is able to do that in 5 hours, he can also apply for a patent with regard to that particular process. So the product as well as the process can be registered, and both are recognized. The second requirement is that it has to be non-obvious. So let us say, for instance, I come up with a selfie stick. Okay, I have invented a selfie stick. Now, my selfie stick has a length of about 2 meters. Now, you come up with a better selfie stick, and your selfie stick can extend up to 3 meters or 4 meters. Can you register this as a patent? No. So what you're doing is something which is only an extension, an add-on. So simply an add-on cannot be registered as a patent. So if you have to make something different, you have to come up with maybe a remote control selfie stick or something like that. So it again depends on your intellect. So what you will have to do is you have to create a new product, or you're going to create the efficacy of this product in such a manner that it is very distinct from the normal usage. A lot of them have come. Now, say for instance, you have a bag. Traditionally, when you use a bag, you only use it for carrying your products, carrying your requirements. But now you have an anti-theft in it, you have a charger in it, you can charge your phone, you can have a digital lock in it. So all these are innovations which are attached to the bag. So that product per se can still be patented. Now, the third requirement is, yes, I am able to come up with an innovative product. I am also, it is not something which is readily available, so it is non-obvious. But if I'm only going to be making small quantities, like if I can only make 2 or 3 or 4 pieces, or say 10 or 20, it's not going to be helpful to the public, because what you're trying to do is, by registering your patent, you're going to commercially exploit it. So the third requirement is it should be possible for you to industrially exploit it. So the industrial application should also be there. Now let us see what cannot be patented. That is a smaller list in terms of what can be patented is endless, but what cannot be patented is a specific list. What is frivolous or something which is against the natural law cannot be patented. Anything which is against public morality cannot also be patented. A mere discovery or a rearrangement of certain things cannot be done as well. For instance, there was this classic case of Novartis versus Union of India, where there was a drug which was discovered, and that was sought to be patented. But then the patent office rejected, saying that this drug was already known and a mere discovery cannot be patented. The Supreme Court also went ahead and said that no doubt the three requirements of patent, that is, it has to be novel, it has to be non-obvious, and it has to be industrially applied, all these things may exist. But in case of drugs, it also has to have a therapeutical efficacy. So the court said that you simply don't go ahead and patent anything and everything. There is a particular process that you follow, and ultimately what you're looking at is public benefit. While you're commercially exploiting it, this is also something that has to be done. Inventions with regard to atomic energy is not patentable. What cannot also be patented is living organisms. Now, this is how it used to be till the case of Diamond versus Chakraborty in the US. There was a microorganism which was genetically modified, what you call as the GMO, the genetically modified organism. So this particular microorganism had the capability of breaking complex oil compounds into simpler parts, and this organism by itself was not available in nature. It was not found in nature by itself. So what this particular scientist did was, he genetically modified this microorganism so as to do this particular thing of breaking down complex oil substances. So when he applied for patent, there was this question of, can you, because till then living organisms were not allowed patent at all. Of course, it opens a Pandora's box in terms of, you don't know what all people are going to come up in the future. You could also come up, the latest fad is with regard to having designer babies. So you could also go in for a procedure wherein you can specifically alter the DNA of the egg, and you can again place it back into the womb of the mother, so that there are certain modifications which are done to the baby. So there are a lot of ethical questions with regard to that, but then with regard to this living organism, the patent was allowed. So multiple questions started coming up with regard to what else can be patented with regard to living organisms and things like that. Most countries do not quite acknowledge cloning. They say that human cloning should not be allowed, from an ethical standpoint. But then for almost all other purposes, there is a lot of research which is being done in terms of how the human life can be bettered. And the case of Diamond versus Chakraborty has led to a lot of inventions with regard to patenting of living organisms. So once this is done, then it has to be also deposited under the Budapest Treaty. So you now can also have living organisms which can be patented. Okay, so as a patentee, now I have come up with an invention, and I've also registered. Let us say, for instance, I come up with a new kind of a tool which can style your hair in a manner. You just have to comb it, and then you just have to think, and it combs for yourself. Something as innovative as that. So now, as a patentee, I have come up with this particular product, and now I want to register this. So when I want to register it, what are the rights that I'm getting along with this registration? Is that first thing is, you get the right to exploit. That is, you get to commercially exploit it so that you get profits. Now, I am a scientist, and I have created this particular product. But then I'm not very good at marketing, and I'm not sure whether I can really cater it to the public per se. So what happens to my patent is, it is just going to lie in the box. The losses, don't worry. You have other methodologies of exploiting it. If you do not want to disclose the entire process, you can probably do an assignment. That is, you can assign parts of this patent to someone else, and then that can be produced. Now, say for instance, I am not interested in exploiting it at all. I don't have the resources. Okay, I like to create new things, so I want to go back into invention. But at the same time, the invention that I have created should also reach the public. So what do I do now? You can license it. The entire rights can be transferred to somebody, and you get a compensation or royalty, whatever you decide upon, again on a contract. So I have now invented something. I have also registered it. Now suddenly somebody comes and they are going to infringe my right. That is, they are going to make a product which is deceptively similar, which is very, very similar to what I have done. In that case, what do I do? We have the same remedies, like I said, under the Copyright Act. You have an injunction here. You can also claim for damages. You can ask for delivery or destruction of those goods. You can also have a certificate of validity. Now, unlike the copyright, the term of patent is 20 years. Before we signed up for the trade-related aspects of intellectual property rights, the term for protection was 14 years, but now we are on the global standard, so your patent can be protected for 20 years. The next intellectual property that we are going to talk about here is the Trademark Act of 1999. Now, when I want to make something, okay, when I'm wanting to register my product, I would want my product to be the most popular one, which people generally, you know, go ahead and pick up. So I would want it to be something which is unique. That's what we do with our babies as well, isn't it? We want our baby to have a very unique name. So when you're talking about uniqueness, it is again a psychological thing. The more bizarre it is, the more easier it registers. So a trade name or a trademark is something that you want to appeal to the consumers so that they buy your products or they use your services. So keeping that in mind, the Trademark Act gives an array of choices. It can be a trade name, it can be a trademark, it can be a brand, it can be a design, it can be something which is graphically represented, it can be smell, it can be anything at all, it can even be a jingle. So all this can be registered under a trademark. Now, let us say for instance, you buy a particular product. If you think why you buy that product, why do you actually go ahead only for that particular brand? You may have multiple reasons. Suppose, let us say for instance, I use a particular toothpaste. So if you ask me why I use that, I say that's the easiest for me to get. So when I went to the supermarket, that was the first toothpaste, so I just picked it up. Somebody else might say, I like the packaging, the way it was packaged. Somebody else might say, I like the color. Somebody might say, I like the taste of the toothpaste. Somebody else would say that, you know, this is what my grandmother has been using. So we have been using it for a very long time. So that is why I'm using this. So when you're looking at multiple products available in the market, and when you want to woo your customers, what is it that thing which is going to woo them is your trademark. How innovative or how novel can your trademark be? So a trademark can be a product mark, like I said, it the name that you put on your product. It can be a service mark. So if you're providing some services, it can be a service mark or it can be distinct from your trademark as well. I remember AOL having this tagline saying, you've got mail, which became very, very popular. So that is a service mark. You can have a collective mark, that is for a group of people to identify them. You can have a collective trademark, like say for instance in the case of a chartered accountant, you can have a collective mark. Then you can have certification marks. Certification marks that are again given by particular authorities, they say that particular product has a particular quality. Now, we're not saying that the quality is the best in the market, but what we're trying to say is we are certifying that this is the quality that it comes with. So this quality is associated with the consumer. You also have what we call as well-known trademarks, the trademarks which have become super generic. Like say for instance Bajaj or Xerox or Escalator, you know, we've kind of forgotten the synonymous equivalent, Like say for instance, you say, let me get a Xerox and come, but whereas that is the name of a company, actually you want to get a photocopy done. So the trademark has become so generic that people have actually forgotten the other process. So that becomes a well-known trademark, that is a generic trademark. Well-known in terms of like Bajaj or Tata, or you know, irrespective of whether they are going to branch out into the classification of goods that you're looking at, since these are very, very popular, you will be looking at these as well-known trademarks. So if I say, for instance, if I tell you, I am wearing Bata, where will you look at? Automatically, you look at my feet and say, oh, okay, you're wearing Bata, products for Bata. So you know that it is associated with footwear. It is so very well known that if I say I have a lungi which is going to be called as Bata, the trademark office says, no, you cannot register it because it is so very well known. Suppose if I say Tata, Tata produces right from salt to an array of products. So if you say this is a product of Tata, or if you see the trademark of Tata, you automatically go back to the fact that this is the manufacturer. So you go to the source, you presume it to be made by this particular manufacturer. So when you're looking at a trademark, what is it that is permissible for registration? We have two categories. We categorize this requirement. Now the first requirement is distinctiveness. How distinct is your trademark? Because your trademark is something that your consumer is going to associate with. So it better be distinct. So when you're talking about distinctiveness, we again further classify it into two categories. One is the inherent distinctiveness, and the other one is what we call as the acquired distinctiveness. So when you're saying inherently distinctive, you are talking about something which is out of the blue. So that means somebody has not thought of it before at all. For instance, Kodak. Now, Kodak may not have a meaning by itself to the word, but for a lot of us, if we say that, you know, you want to treasure a moment, like how you say cheese, we used to say this will be a Kodak moment. So that is how popular it was. So it is a very fanciful one. So under the inherent distinctiveness, it can be fanciful, as fancy as you want it to be, or it can be arbitrary. The classic example would be Apple. When we were young, the moment you say Apple, we used to only think of the fruit. An apple a day would keep the doctor away. But now, Apple is something which I cannot live without, because that is the brand of my phone. So what happens is, you would have not associated a fruit with a mobile. So it is completely arbitrary, out of the blue. So that again becomes a very distinct trademark, so which falls under the inherent distinctiveness. You can also have suggestive trademarks that is also inherent, like say for instance a Microsoft. Okay, so you know that it is a particular software which is being used, and it is also suggestive of the fact that what is going to be the purpose for which it is used. One of the classic examples used to be Fair and Lovely, but now of course since it is disputed, it is we'll have to now wait and watch what Fair and Lovely is going to call itself. The fairness screen is now going to be named with a different name. Now, other than this, you can also have acquired distinctiveness. So it can either be, what you mean by acquired distinctiveness is the distinctiveness has been acquired over a period of time. So how long is this time period? There is no specific period, but it is the appeal which is made by the consumers towards this particular product. Like say for instance, if you're going to talk about Dr. Batra's. So Dr. Batra's has acquired a distinctiveness, because ideal case scenario, we do not allow personal names to be registered anymore. Multiple cases have been there in terms of Mahindra and a lot of cases have been there earlier as well. So now we do not allow personal names or geographic names to be used along with a trademark. But then if you talk about a few names which were there in the market earlier and which have acquired their distinctiveness because of that particular product or service that they have rendered, that becomes distinct. So when you are talking about this descriptive trademark, if the descriptive trademark is coupled with either a fanciful name, or if the descriptive trademark is coupled with an arbitrary name, then it can still be registered under the Trademark Act of 1999. Okay. I have now come up with a particular name for my business or my product. I have my trademark. So what all can it be? Like I said, it can be a device, it can be a brand, it can be a label, it can be words or letters combination. But you cannot specifically register colors unless it is in a particular combination or alphabets, colors. So it's a scheme that you're going to put all together. So if like say for instance, if I want to register a trademark and I want my logo to have the alphabet A, A alone cannot be registered. But if I'm going to write the A in a fanciful manner, and if I'm going to give it a particular combination which is not available in the market, if I think of A now, I can think of Airtel, I can think of Act. So I should not be infringing any of their trademarks. So I have to have a distinct style of writing my name, a distinct combination, which then is put under a particular search. And then if it is not similar to anybody else, then I will be given a trademark. Signatures can also be registered as a trademark. So what cannot be registered as a trademark is anything which is not distinct or anything which is going to create a deception in the minds of people. If you're going to have two products which are going to be similar looking, or the packaging is very similar, then that trademark will not be allowed. Now the question is, why would I want to make something which is similar to somebody else? Let us say, for instance, I am coming up with noodles. I'm going to manufacture noodles, and I call my noodles Nagi noodles. So now what happens is there is already a player in the market which is called as Maggi. And if I have to come up with my Nagi noodles, then one thing is it is a very popular brand. Second thing is it phonetically sounds similar. So I will not be given a trademark. Also, what will happen is if I'm going to put it out in the market, then there can be people who can mistake, a different form of Maggi as and Nagi. So for that purpose, I will not be allowed to branch out into this particular thing. So I have to come up with an innovative trademark. So it cannot be deceptively similar. Why would I want to do a deceptively similar trademark is because of the fact that I want to now use the goodwill. I already know that Nestle as a company has a goodwill, and Maggi is a very popular noodle with the children as well. So if I'm going to create a Maggi noodle and package it in a yellow color and put it for sale, children may automatically pick that up thinking it is a product which is from the same manufacturer. So what I'm now trying to do is I'm not only infringing their trademark, I'm also trying to utilize their goodwill. So I will not be allowed to register my trademark with that particular name. And anything which is scandalous or which is against the morality cannot be registered as a trademark. Let me give you a classic example. Okay. If you have heard of this line of clothing called as FC UK, which is French Connection United Kingdom. Now, the combination of words, I just have to interchange two alphabets and the whole thing changes. But FC UK has been registered as a trademark. So isn't it scandalous? There was a case which was filed in the US, and the court came up with a finding saying that no, it is not scandalous because you don't pronounce it, as a cuss word. You rather call it still as FCUK, as an acronym. Okay, you do not, use words which are scandalous. So if I register it as F star and C and K, then that will not be permissible because it is scandalous, it is obscene, it is against public morality. So there are classic cases where the trademark office has gone ahead and analyzed the way a particular word has been projected. So a scandalous mark cannot be permitted as well. And the term of a trademark is generally 20 years. So I have established my trademark in the real world. I have made my product very popular, and now people want to also go ahead and order it online. So what I want to do is I want to create a virtual space as well. So now I'm looking for a domain name. So along with my trademark, I will also be looking at a domain name. So the domain name is that name which is there between the www dot and the dot org or dot com or whatever, you know. So that part is your domain name. Now, let us say, for instance, I have been in the market for the last 20 years and now suddenly I feel that I have to also branch out into the virtual area. So when I go ahead and look for registering my domain name with my same trademark which is there in the real world, which my consumers relate to, I find that somebody has already registered. And when I do a little bit of research into it to find out what is it that that person is selling, is it a similar product? Then I find out that this particular person has simply registered it and is not using it. So I can approach the person and say, look, see, I'm doing this business and I would want my domain name to be registered with this name because it's easier. The person now starts trading with me. He says, okay, I will give this domain name to you, but then you have to give me so much money. So he is referred to somebody whom we call as a cyber squatter. Now, a cyber squatter is a person who squats in the cyberspace and does not have the intention of actually using that particular space for any business. It is only from the perspective of putting me or blackmailing me into paying that person that money so that that thing can be used for me in the future purposes. That means I can get the domain name in the future. Now, since this was a rampant practice, there's an organization which is called as ICANN, which now looks into all these cyber squatting. It is the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, and they now play a huge role in controlling this cyber squatting. So one of the first cases of cyber squatting in India is called as Yahoo versus Akash Arora. Now, we all heard of Yahoo. Yahoo is very popular. So when the defendant wanted to have a domain name and the plaintiff had resistance saying that, we are very popular, the court did acknowledge saying that, yes, you cannot have a similar domain name. Similarly, also, the case of Rediff and Radiff, the spelling for Rediff is R-E-D-I-F-F and Radiff is R-A-D-I-F-F. So the argument which was put forth in this case is very interesting. Generally, who uses the internet is people who are literate. So the defendant's contention was that when you have literate people who are accessing the system, would they make a spelling mistake? Now, how many of us know spellings really well? We just have to think about it. So when that is being thought about, so the court did reject the application of the defendant saying that, people on the net do not generally make spelling mistakes. So it sounds phonetically similar and it also visually appears very similar. So it was deceptively similar and hence this application was upheld in terms of the plaintiff and Radiff was not allowed to be registered as a domain name. Let me move on to the next concept, which is the concept of geographical indications. Now, in case of geographical indication, I will take you back a little in time. There was this classic case of basmati rice. We all know basmati rice, particularly, for the country which eats a lot of rice. We affiliate ourselves to basmati rice, and the moment you think of basmati rice, you're thinking about the size of the rice, the aroma. We, hold it a lot from a traditional value as well. So when a particular company in the US, what they did was they were able to increase this aromatic flavor of this rice, and they called it as Texmati, and they got it patented as well. Now, that is when the Indian government objected, saying that we have been growing this rice for more than about 1,000 years. It has been growing in the foothills of Himalayas and this particular Sindh region, which is between India and Pakistan. Both these countries produce this basmati rice and it has a particular flavor and we have a global presence as well. And with this Texmati or this US company getting a patent over this particular rice, more than about 10% of the exports would be affected. So the country is resisted and then the patent was refused. And we realized that there were quite a few products like this rice, turmeric was also patented, and we had to really fight out our case. So a lot of things had to be protected. So once we became signatories to the TRIPS, in the year 1999, this Geographical Indications Act was also passed. And what we generally say is that with regard to geographic indications, it's a little apart from the other IPRs in the sense that this right is not given to an individual. It is given to a group of people who are producing a product which has got a specific nature because of the geography in which it is grown. For instance, let us talk about Coorg coffee. You know, let's say you walk into a house and you can smell the nice flavor and then say, ah, it smells so good. Hey, the brooder. Okay. So then the coffee beans may be coming from Coorg. So when you're talking about the climatic conditions or the very nature of that area where those products are grown contributes to the quality of that particular product, it can be registered under the geographic indications. Currently, at this point in time, we have about 370 geographic indications which are registered, and it can be registered across various heads. It can be a natural product. One of the classic examples of a natural product being registered as a GI is the Markana marble, which has its origin in Rajasthan. Other than that, it could be a product which is an agricultural produce. Like I was giving you an example of Coorg coffee, Darjeeling tea, it could be any of these Nagpur oranges. Each one has its own distinct taste, which is a contribution of that topography. It could be a manufactured product like the Goan Feni. A lot of spirits fall under this particular classification, including tequila, scotch whiskey and things like that. You also have the handicrafts. Like say for instance, Karnataka is very famous for the Chennapatna toys, or you can be talking about the Tanjore painting. So these are all handicrafts which can again be registered under the geographical indications. It could be a Varli painting. So why should somebody go ahead and protect something like this? Is because it has an identity with the particular country. So when we say Basmati rice, or when we say Chennapatna toys, or when you say Mysore Mallige, you are associating that with that territory in that particular country. So there is a lot of revenue which is drawn as well, and its popularity is such that it has a market from around the world. If you're talking about Pashmina shawls, you know, everybody who generally comes to India would want to procure one. So there is a lot of economic impact on it as well. The next IPR that I would want to talk about is the designs. Okay. Now, design again is a very unique concept. You are not looking at utility. You are just looking at the aesthetic part. Let us say, for instance, you walk into a perfume store, and you just get attracted to the bottle of that particular perfume. You may not know the fragrance of it, but you just like the way it is. The shape of that particular bottle, or you walk into a wine shop and the bottle of that wine is very attractive to you, may not attract anybody else. So the aesthetic sense is only to you. So as a consumer, you want to buy it only for the way it looks, that is the aesthetic sense. That can also be protected under the Designs Act. Now, when you go into the official website, you will see an array of designs which have been registered. You have certain lines of clothing by Sabyasachi Mukherjee also, which is registered under the Designs Act. You have particular bottles in particular shapes. Now, we all know that the liquids take the shape of the bottle. So how is it important as to how the bottle looks? It is from the consumer's perspective. The consumer has an aesthetic taste towards it, and if he feels that it should be used, then it can be used. So the Designs Act 2000 protects all these designs. And the requirement again is it has to be original. You have to be able to produce it industrially, and it cannot have any utility. It should only be from the design, that is the aesthetic perspective. Very popular in furniture and jewelry making with regard to watches, the dials that you have and all that. So in all these areas, the Designs Act is very, very popular. The next act that I want to talk to you about is the Semiconductor Integrated Circuits Layouts Designs Act of 2000. Now, we all use gadgets left, right and center, and we use a lot of these equipments which have these semiconductors, which has these integrated chips. If this integrated chip in a semiconductor, the topography of it, if it is going to be something which is distinct, which is going to be original, you can go ahead and register it under the act. Now, earlier, this was not as popular, but then with the usage of a lot of the equipments like your TV ICs or your mobile phones or your laptops, this became a market which could be exploited and good profits could be made out of it. So that is why you have an act which also protects, and it's the requirement, like I said, it has to be original and it has to be distinct. The last thing that I will be touching upon under this aspect is the Protection of Plant Varieties and Farmers' Rights Act 2001 and the Biological Diversity Act of 2002. Now, this is again a sui generis law that we have made, very much to fall in line with the TRIPS requirement. Now, under this act, plants are protected in the sense that, let us say for instance, if I am able to devote my time and if I am able to come up with a new variety of plant, this plant doesn't exist in nature by itself, but I am putting in my intellect, I am putting in a lot of hard work, and because of which if I have come up with a new variant, in that case I can go ahead and get it registered under this particular category. So that is the new variety. Extant variety is all those plants which have an origin in India and which have been recognized to be originally from India have been registered under the extant variety. You all also have something called as the farmer's variety. So under the farmer's variety, it is those varieties which have been traditionally cultivated by the farmers. We speak about a lot of these GMO products, that is the genetically modified objects, or we talk about a lot of benefits that we draw from these plants. So at some point in time, it became required that we had to protect them from a conservation perspective. So the objective of the Biodiversity Act 2002 is for conservation of the bioresources. It also emphasizes on equitable sharing of benefits. Now that means if I'm going to exploit a particular plant variety and if I'm going to get some profits out of it, the people who originally have knowledge about it should also get some benefits from it, and that is called as the benefit sharing. It also makes it punishable for biopiracy, that is you cannot take plants which are specific to India anywhere outside the geographical location of India. The two other things which are of importance under the IPR regime, one is about trade secrets and the other one is about traditional knowledge. Say for instance, if you catch a cold, I'm talking about the before COVID situation. Okay, so if you catch a cold and if you sneeze, the best thing that you would do is boil milk, add a little bit of turmeric and add a little bit of pepper to it, and you will be asked to drink it pretty hot. So this was something which is a traditional knowledge, because we knew that turmeric has antibiotic properties and pepper gives you a lot of relief from cold. Now this is a traditional knowledge. And till about this Basmati's case, we hadn't taken our traditional knowledge very seriously, I would say. There were a lot of things that we would do and which was not documented. Either it was not documented because it was a secret that they wanted to maintain, or it was not documented for the simple reason that they did not think that it can be exploited by somebody else. So when the patenting became rampant and when they started realizing that our traditional knowledge had to be conserved, they came up with this digital library, a platform which is called as the Traditional Knowledge Digital Library. And this platform has got about 13 million pages, that's what I read. And they have a lot of entries, right, from your Mysore Rasam or anything at all that you would want to register. You could register it under this TKDL, because what happens is once you publish, you cannot patent it. So if you publish something, and when there is a prior art search done, that particular thing cannot be patented in any country at all. So from that perspective, they started publishing a lot of recipes, a lot of traditional knowledge, medicines, Ayurvedic procedures, Yunani, all those kind of things have been protected under this particular regime. With regard to trade secrets, we don't have a specific law in India, but a lot of trade secrets are very popular, like say for instance the preparation of Coca-Cola, or with regard to the KFC's recipe, all these are protected. If it is a particular process, like I said, it can still be, if it is an innovative process which is not known and which has not been published earlier, it can still be protected under the patented regime. So with regard to the IPRs, I hope you have had enough insight into what exactly it is. Hi, welcome back to my session on cyber laws and cyber crimes. In India, we don't have a law which is called as cyber law. So what we refer to is the Information Technology Act of 2000. And why we need to know about this particular act is that in our day-to-day life, we are involved with a lot of aspects of this particular law. So let me start with the simplest, which is an e-contract. Every time that we do certain things, even in our day-to-day lives, we enter into varied contracts. Like say for instance, I'm not just talking about the ones that you sign off, I'm also talking about the ones where you don't even verbally agree on. Let us say you get into an auto to reach your workplace. You have consciously entered into a contract to pay the driver. So similarly, in the virtual world as well, you have multiple contracts that you enter into. Every time that you download an app, or every time that you are trying to install a particular software, you will be entering into contracts. So I'm going to talk to you about two basic types of contracts. One is a shrink wrap contract and the other one is a click wrap contract. For those who buy the software, I'm not talking about the pirated version, the actual versions, you will see a small white line which runs on the plastic cover. So the moment you take that off, you have already entered into a contract that's called as a shrink wrap contract. And after you insert the CD, and then it pops up with a question whether do you want to accept or decline, and you say accept. Now that becomes a click wrap contract. I know most of us, the moment we download a particular app or when we go onto websites, we are hardly bothered about the terms and conditions, though that pops up and says accept or decline. Earlier, this option for decline was not there. Subsequently, when it was challenged in the US courts, they added this option for decline. So the presumption is that you have read all the terms and conditions. Now, by default, whenever you are logging into any of your accounts or when you're creating a new account, all that we do is scroll down the whole thing, say accept. We don't even bother to read the contents of that particular document. Logically speaking, what is the point? Because anyway, I'm not going to be able to change the clauses there. I can't go back and say, hey, Mr. Pichai, I'm not okay with clause number 6, 8 and 10. Can you change that for me? Because it's a standard form contract. However, knowing what you are signing into is very, very important. So when you are signing a contract, please be aware and then go ahead and sign off. That is, when you agree, know what you are agreeing to. Now, like how we sign off, that is a signature is put on the real contracts, that is when a contract is signed off on a paper. Similarly, you have something called as a digital signature when you are signing off e-contracts. Section 3 of the Information Technology Act speaks about what a digital contract is, a digital signature is. And it also speaks about how recognized it is, or what is the authentication given to such signatures. Legally speaking, there's not much of a difference between the physical signature that we put and the digital signature that we use. So in case of a digital signature, there are two keys. One is a private key and a public key. So this is what is given to the users. So one person is going to send out, let us say I'm sending out a mail with a digital signature, and I'm going to ensure that none of the material in it or nothing has been tampered with. So the other person who gets this email When he uses this other key, the public key, he is able to access it. So while sending and receiving, when you use a digital signature, you are sure that it is not tampered with and the material there is digitally verified. Now, the procedure for obtaining this digital signature is also enumerated in the Act. And you just have to approach the authority. There is a named authority who certifies, giving out these digital signatures, who's called as a certifying authority under the Act. There is a procedure which is laid down as well. So anybody who wishes to claim this or to subscribe for this digital signature can approach this authority and get the signature done. This is with regard to the Information Technology Act part of it. Now, why we're talking about this particular act is because we want to understand what a cyber crime is. The moment we say cyber crime, we think that it is a crime and we know it is done in the cyberspace. Now, neither cyberspace nor cyber crime has been defined under the Information Technology Act. So what we understand is any act which is a crime, which is defined under the Act, and if it has been done using a computer peripherals, any of these digital platforms, all that can fall under the cybercrime perspective. Ideal case scenario, whenever you even Google for images on cybercrime, the first thing that you see is there will be a person whose face is not seen, maybe a hooded image or something like that. So what you're trying to say is that in other crimes, you may be able to identify the accused, but in a cyber crime, identifying the accused becomes very difficult. So because of which, there are multiple issues. So that is one of the things which makes it very, very different. The second thing which makes a cyber crime different from the other crimes is with regard to the jurisdiction. We have come up with a few tests with regard to how to establish the jurisdiction. However, we still have a long way to go in terms of identifying the right jurisdiction so as to enable to get the best reliefs. Now, under the Information Technology Act, Section 43 speaks about a list of about 10 things in terms of what we generally call as hacking and phishing and things like that. It speaks from a more civil perspective, okay, from the civil remedy perspective. So what it also says is that anybody who violates any of these things, like say for instance, if I'm going to access a person's computer without his permission, if I'm going to download anything, or if I'm going to transfer anything into the computer, or if I'm going to put in something which is going to hamper the normal functioning of the computer, all this comes under Section 43, and the compensation, the damages can go up to the extent of 1 crore. Yes, you heard me right. It can go up to 1 crore rupees. The criminal aspect of it is put under Section 66. What it says is, it's the similar kind of things which is said under 43, but then there are two words which are added here. One is that you are going to committing an act. Sorry. Okay, I forgot those two words. It's there on the paper.
Dishonestly
and fraudulently. Okay. So whatever has been. Okay, should I take a second and then start? Whatever has been said under Section 43 gets culminated into a criminal offence if it is under Section 66. So what we are saying is, it is the same kind of acts that you do under Section 43, but what you are doing is, here you are doing it dishonestly and fraudulently. Again, both words have the same meaning that we use under the Indian Penal Code. So dishonestly and fraudulently, if you're going to do any of the acts which would have otherwise been a civil wrong, will now become a criminal act. So Section 66 speaks about, you have Section B, C, D, E, F, which speaks about various crimes. Section 67 speaks about publishing anything which is an obscene information. Again, obscenity has been defined under the Penal Code. Anything which is publicly immoral, something which is unacceptable, or something which is so pervert that a person, if they see that it can lead them to such perversion, is something which we refer generally to as an obscene information. Section 69 speaks about the power of the government to interfere or to make intercept, monitor, and to decrypt messages. So this is a special power which is given to the government. This can be used in exceptional situations. Section 70 speaks about unauthorized access to protected systems. So if there are systems which are protected and if you are going to unauthorizedly access them, then Section 70 speaks about the punishment as well for such offenses. Section 72 is with regard to breach of confidentiality and privacy. Let's say, for instance, you have a few pictures, you have accessed pictures of somebody without their permission, and you have also published it somewhere. So you are breaching confidentiality and privacy of that particular person. You could be held liable under Section 72. Section 73 speaks about publishing false digital signature certification. That means you are attaching a digital signature, like I said, under Section 3. It is an authentication, right? So if you're going to publish something which is appearing to be got from that certifying authority, there again you can be held liable. So multiple crimes happen in the cyberspace, but I'm just going to talk to you about five major crimes which happen. First one is identity theft. When we speak about identity theft, it can amount to anything, right from taking your personal details, accessing your bank accounts, accessing sensitive information. It could be anything at all. It encompasses multitude of crimes which can take away your identity. Like say, for instance, accessing your Aadhaar card or accessing your bank account details. All this can amount to identity theft. The second kind of attacks that which happen in the cyberspace is the psychological attacks. Now, generally what we say is keep away from strangers. Don't get into personal conversations with people, particularly in chat rooms. Do not disclose any of your details so that they get to know you, or you're giving them a chance to blackmail you against something which you really don't want to be held against. So when you're talking about the psychological threats, a lot of them, particularly the youngsters, are falling into this particular category. They are either lured into a relationship which they think is real. Again, like I said, the advantage here is that your identity can be completely concealed. So the person who's getting involved with you wouldn't even know who you actually are. So there are multiple problems with regard to this. Then social media attacks. It could be hate speeches, it could be posting your pictures, it could be just following you on social media. Again, all of us, we may not speak to our family as often, but then we speak on the social media quite a bit. You might just say, oh, I'm having a headache, and then you'll post a picture, a selfie with a headache. Or you might say, I'm just going out on a trip to so-and-so, so-and-so, I'm not going to come back for two days. Now, what you're doing is you're sending out signals to probable criminals who know that you're not going to be in that particular place for the next 2 days, and makes it very, very convenient for them. So be very careful about what you are posting on the social media. I'm sure you have got a lot of messages from your banks. They keep telling you emails and SMSs or any other mode of communication from your bank. They will say, do not divulge your passwords. Your bank never asks you for your card details or CVV numbers and all that. Now, a lot of bank frauds happen, a lot of phishing happens with regard to this, a lot of spamming happens in terms of card details. So you'll have to be very careful about your bank information. Whenever you are handling your bank accounts through the e-platform, whether it be through your internet banking on your laptop or whether you're accessing it through a mobile app, you'll have to be very careful about what kind of information you're feeding in, and you need to ensure that nobody else is watching any of this information as well. The next one is with regard to the virus attacks. This, I think most of you would know. If you're going to, let us say, of course now not many of us go to the cyber cafes, but earlier when cyber cafes were the only alternative for us to access internet, we would go there, and if you probably insert an external drive like a pen drive or something, you are sure to be infected with some kind of virus. So whenever you're inserting any external device on your systems, please ensure that you run them through some antivirus software, and ensure that you buy this software. Do not download a free version. a few safety tips is what I thought I will share here, more from a protection perspective, from a prevention perspective. Now, the provisions of law are there. The authorities are very much available. But I thought that as, you know, people who are netizens, since we are so used to the cyberspace now, and particularly with the current situation where we cannot venture out into the real world much, we are venturing out left, right and center into the virtual world. So what are the things that we need to be careful about? Little bit of a hygiene with regard to the cyber world is what I thought I will share with you. So first one is, whenever you go to probably any registration, if you have signed off, they'll ask you for your left thumb impression. Do not take pictures where your left thumb is shown, or if you are using any of your fingerprints for biometrics, I would suggest do not expose any of those fingerprints to anybody. Even a normal camera nowadays seems to have a very good resolution, which now can increase the possibility of that particular fingerprint being used for the wrong purposes. Do not open your digital locks. Now, most of our homes, gone are those days where you put a key and then open the door. We all have digital locks on our main doors. Do not open your digital locks when you are on a call, particularly if you are on a video call. You are giving room or you're giving space for others to get information about this. Now, you may be talking to someone who's very close to you. Let us say you're trying to open the door and you're talking to your mother, but then there may be somebody else who's watching at you because you don't know where your mother is. So do not do any such thing. Do not download unwanted apps. Be a little more conscious when you are downloading apps. Of course, it is a fab thing. For every other thing, you have an app, and it is there are a lot of free download apps. But let us say, for instance, you are downloading a camera app. Now, the camera app should have only access to your camera. Why should it have access to your contacts? Why should it have access to your messages? Why should it have access to your other bank accounts? Now, some of them give you a free trial. They say that, okay, for the first 1 year, we're not going to charge you. Give us your card details, and after 1 year is when we are going to charge you. So you give your details to them. Okay, and it so happens that within a very short time, and with our memory, you may not even remember that you have signed up for this one. Within a very short time that you can see, you will be able to see that somebody has accessed this, your bank information. Now, very commonly read news in the newspaper is that somebody calls you and they say that this is the transaction. You can just transfer 1 rupee and you can see that. And subsequently, they call you back and say, oh, the OTP didn't come. I'll give you another number, and then you know the OTP gets delivered to that, and immediately there's a lot of money which is missing from your mobile phones. So be very careful about such transactions as well. Do not give permission for accessing any of your systems if you're not going to be around. When we're talking about the offenses which we spoke about, either under Section 43 or under whether it is under Section 66. What we're talking about is unauthorized access. But if you're going to allow somebody to use your system, and if you're not going to be around, if you have fed in your password and somebody says, oh, my system is not working, can I use this? Again, you have to be sensitive about where you are, but then be very careful about sharing any of your systems anything that is vulnerable to be hacked or for anybody to use it differently. As a matter of practice, thumb rule, never share your password. Okay, let it be anybody, the closest person as well, never share your password, because you do not know who else is watching this. In fact, as a joke, there was a friend of mine who said, I would even share my toothbrush with my husband, but not my password. So I think that is the same sense that you should also follow. With the present COVID situation and students being able to go to school, let us as parents also be a little more conscious, and let us educate our children about the cyber hygiene. So as parents, let us ensure that we educate our children on the usage of internet. We also need to ensure that they are able to recognize what apps are healthy and what apps are not healthy. As a parent, I'm not asking you to peek into what they are doing, but then be a little conscious about websites they are visiting. Now, they may not know the risks which are involved, but you surely know what kind of risks are involved. There is
the primary liability of a parent to protect their children against cyber pornography, which is the child pornography, and also with regard to child sexual abuse material, which we call as CSAM. So you have to be very, very careful that they are not prone to being exploited, nor are they looking at any such content. Now, as a teenager or as a youngster, you also have to be conscious about what kind of material that you are accessing. Never accept requests from strangers. If you see a lot of crimes which are happening around, is because of this particular crime, in the sense that they do not realize what they are getting into. Pictures that you post are very, very important. Do not share any of your personal pictures with any of the strangers. Do not do anything which can put you in trouble in front of a mobile device or your laptop. When you are not using your laptop, ensure that the camera is sealed, because automatically there are some images which are taken and we do not know how it is going to be used. It could go to a black web. And do not allow anybody to click your pictures without your permission. Let us say, for instance, if there is somebody who is clicking pictures and you have objections to it, please tell them very clearly that you do not want them to click pictures, and then you can also report this to the police as well. So what you can do is, in case any of these things happen to you, you can approach the nearest cyber police station. You also have a helpline number. You can access the helpline number, which is 155260. You can give a call on that. There is also a website called as the National Cyber Crime Reporting Portal, a very effective portal. Whatever I have spoken to you so far is also available on the portal. There is a particular page that you can access to educate your children on what to use and what not to use. Please go ahead and maintain safety. Do not be under the impression that I am above this. I may never be able to, or I may never come in a situation like this. With the kind of gadgets that we are using, with the multiple accounts that we have, with the bank transactions that we are doing, every day in and day out, now we are in the e-bus. So please be very careful and do not let anybody exploit you. Thank you.